First of all, I'd like to compliment Romania on the way that you, its membership of the European Union, the fact that through good policy, you have been able to bring your income per head up quite quickly, approaching the European average or move towards the European average. Not a very good case. This has been based, of course, on good sound administration. Certainly from the Irish experience, we found in our catch-up with the European Union average that was very important to have a political public administration and to have a court system that had been independent of any political influence. These have been important factors here in Romania, and they remain important for the attraction of investment which was funding them. And Joe was just asking about it. I'd like also to compliment the tremendous work that you've already done in coping with refugees coming from the war, the invasion of Ukraine by Russia. And I think that Romania is a model in terms of its ability to cope with unexpected disasters. You have tremendous capacity in that area and you're displaying it. But this invasion has been described by the European Council as a tectonic European history. It has been described by Jeremy Fink of BlackRock, the investment and the asset manager, as heralding the end of globalization as we have known it for the last 30 years. It's important to remind ourselves that this invasion by Russia of a neighboring peaceful country, Ukraine, is a breach of the United Nations Charter to which Russia is signatory. It is a denial of self-determination to the Ukrainian people, and self-determination to be one of the basis of our nations of invasion. It is an attempt by force to impose a view of identity on a people, which is something that is entirely impermissible. This is not just a contest between democracy and autocracy. It is a contest between a system of international relations based on predictable rules and a system of international relations based solely on raw force. As a result of this invasion, nations all over Europe are going to have to divert resources away from social programs to defense. And this is going to involve hardship for many people. The cost of living will be prominently increased for all families all over Europe. Now, of course, there will be collective actions by some in powerful positions to ensure that the increased costs are not borne by them, but by all borne by other more vulnerable or less well-organized groups. And that's going to lead to major social tensions at the times we experienced in the 1970s. I was in fact in government in the 1970s for the Eurocrats, and one of the responsibilities that I had was price control. And I know how contentious pricing decisions, speaking on in a period of inflation, where people are jumping to ensure that others, rather than they, bear the burdens. Now I'd like to refer to what has been done at European level already in the past few weeks to deal with these challenges. And I think it's important to say that the European Council, which has as head of government, which has been making all of these decisions, operates on the basis of unanimity. All 27 must agree. And it is quite an achievement that in a short space of time, the European Union has been able to make such progress on so many areas. And I would identify five areas where action has already been taken. First of all, a complete reset of European relations with the United States. Secondly, a major step forward on European defense. Thirdly, a major step forward on energy independence for Europe. Fourthly, a major step forward on solidarity with countries who are having to cope with major refugee flows. And finally, a major step forward on food security, ensuring that we have enough to eat in Europe and that neighbors have enough to eat. In regard to relations with the United States, We've established a task force on energy security, jointly between the European Union and the United States. We have agreed on a major program of sanctions, which will involve substantial costs for Europe, but which are necessary in order to remind Russia and remind other countries who might seek to imitate Russia that what Russia has done bears a heavy price. We have agreed a program with the United States for liquid natural gas supplies. And importantly, too, we have agreed with the United States a program for governing the digital space, which was previously an issue of contention between the United States and Europe. Now we've got a common position. That's a major step forward on all those issues in the recent few weeks. We have also agreed in Europe on a stronger and more capable Europe in the field of defense and security, a rapid deployment force, more investment in research and development in defense, and of course also much closer cooperation in the area of cyber security. Obviously, these are big decisions. The key will be in implementation. It's one thing to agree something at first sight, it's another thing to do it on the ground in your ministry for defense, your ministry for justice, and your ministry. That will have to be monitored very tightly to ensure that Europe delivers this time. Thirdly, we have taken major steps to reduce dependence on Russian energy and indeed on Russian minerals and so on. Program for the development of the hydrogen economy, additional emphasis on renewable energy, and I think very importantly in this area, an arrangement with the support of Moldova to ensure continued electricity supplies to Ukraine and respect a war that we talked about the alternative that's been for. And fourthly, we have agreed to establish a solidarity trust fund, which will help countries like Romania, like Poland, like Slovakia and others who are coping with the flow of refugees, help them financially to deal with this. And we will be able to do that because of the earlier decisions we took in the wake of the COVID crisis to give the European Union a capacity to buy a very important step forward, which wouldn't have happened, I think, were it not for the COVID crisis, but which I think gives the European Union a capacity, a space to buy the capacity of the European Union, the capacity of being a state, the capacity to buy is the capacity to plan ahead. And finally, we have taken steps in the last few weeks to deal with the imminent threat to our food security. It is important to say that I think it's 12% of all the calories consumed in the world are produced from the wheat fields of Russia and Ukraine. The dependency of countries like Turkey and Egypt and Tunisia for the wheat that they consume in their local products on imports of wheat from Ukraine and Russia is enormous. So stabilizing world food supplies is going to be very important to stick to avoiding major outbreaks of starvation and also preserving peace in the Middle East. And here in this area, it is good to say that thanks to the common agriculture policy, the often maligned common agriculture policy, the European Union does have food security. We have sufficient supplies, sufficient capacity to produce wheat, barley, meat, and dairy products. But we have a major dependence on imported imports input to agriculture. Fertilizer. We don't produce enough fertilizer for Europe. Pesticides and other things that are necessary for the production of food. Europe is not self-sufficient in those things. But while in the short term, we are capable of feeding ourselves in the medium to long term with our current dependency on imports, we are vulnerable. So, here in this area, decisions are being taken by the European Union to invest heavily in research and development, in improvements in plant breeding, in precision farming, and in renewable systems of farming that will enable us to be less dependent on imported inputs, and of course, sustainable in our processes. I think it's important to say that many of the changes that the European Union is going to have to endure, and indeed the decisions that it has had to make, were decisions we were probably going to have to make anyway, because ones that we were going to need to make anyway if we were to commit our climate change commitments. Unfortunately, because of the war in Iran and Ukraine, we're going to have to do this much faster and with greater social disruption than we would otherwise have to undertake. But at least we're moving in the right direction in terms of climate change as well. I do stress again that the major challenge for the European Union will be implementation. We are good at European Council meetings, and I would have to do the right thing. That means very broad general declarations of intentions. It's the detailed work of following up on implementation to ensure that commitments are implemented in detail in every government department in every country of the 27 member states of the European Union. That's going to be the big challenge, as it is indeed the big challenge for government. Implementation is far more difficult than policy making. I think it's also fair to say, and I think this will have been reflected in the contribution we had from the United States last night, that the United States is at the moment deeply committed to Europe, and President Biden has been tremendously supportive of European institutions in the existence of crisis. But the United States has other worries. It has a worry particularly to do with the competition with China, the future of Taiwan, and it has to spread its resources over more than one potential state. And I think, therefore, we can't assume that the level of interest that's now been displayed by the United States in Europe and in Spain will remain at the same intensity 5, 10, 15, 20 years from now. And that's why we have to put our money where our commitments are in terms of developing European defense and European capacity to I think that will probably also eventually require some changes in the treaties of the European Union. The idea that we can make all the important strategic decisions, and they are made at the European Council rather than in the Commission, make all of these on the basis of unanimity, it's different. We're probably going to need to go a super qualified majority voting, but we don't need to ensure that we have a capacity now where we can make decisions, but to follow and ensure that those decisions are implemented. These are challenging times, and it's very challenging that we're having this discussion